Imagine waking up tomorrow morning and you have no memory. You don't know where you are. You don't know who you are. You don't know what your life would be like. You're in the body of an adult. You see the world through the eyes of a newborn. So you're seeing it for the very first time. How do you feel? Scared? Confused? Bewildered? That was my reality in 2017 when I had a brain injury, and after being in a coma for 3 weeks, I woke up and I had no memory. So I didn't know where I was. I didn't know who I was, and I didn't know what my life had been like. I have no memory of the first 6 months of 2017, so I don't remember falling ill. But apparently, I was looking after my friend's house and she came home to find me very unwell. I was taken to hospital by ambulance, where I was diagnosed with Crohn's disease. And that led to a combination of bacterial meningitis, which is an inflammation of the protective layer that causes our brain and spinal cord, and encephalitis, which is a swelling or inflammation of the brain itself. I also had severe sepsis, which is the body's extreme reaction to infection. How many people do you think die every hour in the UK from sepsis? 1, 2, 3, 5 people die every hour in the UK alone from sepsis. It's known as the silent killer. My sister sat by my side day after day, week after week, so she took it in terms of the nurses to rub the knuckles into my chest as I was drawing what they called the death breath. And when I did stop breathing, the crash team would come rushing in the room and push her out of the way as they brought her back to life. On one of those occasions, she ran more and said she'd been told I was going to die that night. And although I survived, I finally definitely died. After 5 weeks, I was transferred to a recovery unit in another hospital. And that's where I had the first memories of my new life. The first memories of my sister sitting to the hospital bed, asking me, why are you swearing so much? And apparently that's quite a common reaction for someone who's just come out of being in a coma. I have no idea how I started to use a computer again, or who showed me the passwords, but that's where I started to learn what the past life had been like. I have made my living running music groups in psychiatric hospitals. I worked with people with special needs, I was a drum teacher. One day I found a website where there was someone who looked just like me sitting behind this strange looking array of musical instruments. I thought, what is that I'm sitting behind? What did I do with those things? So that was my world. It was one room and a window, and I was safe and cared for. And then I started to learn about the outside world. Mum rang one day and I said, Mum, who's Donald Trump? I've heard he's president of the world. She said, not the world, David, America. She said, do you remember being in America last year? Oh, I wasn't in America. She said, you were, you were in California, you were in Texas. Mum, what does it mean that we've left Europe? How can we leave Europe? She said, David, I know you don't remember, and this is really hard for you, but honestly, I don't think anyone quite understands that. Then she told me about the bombing at the concert in Manchester and the attacks on the bridges in London. And I did not understand. Why do we treat each other like this? See, I hadn't yet been taught about divisions that exist between people from different cultures or religions, the idea of them and us. I just saw people. I just saw us. After 2.5 months, I was discharged, driven home by ambulance, and I was taken onto the flat. This was the first thing I saw, and I thought, oh my God,
it's real.
Carers came to the house twice a day to take me for walks, take me shopping, and make sure I was okay. Well, I started to get really scared. I felt like I moved into the home, someone died, but all his possessions were still there. So I started to frantically, almost obsessively clear everything out. And I would sell anything I could sell. I would give away anything I couldn't sell. Anything I would sell, I'd give away. I would destroy it and throw it away. As the days went by, I got more and more scared. All I could see was this brutal, unforgiving world, and I couldn't understand. I died. I've been set free. Why would I come back to this? However, I had some amazing friends and an amazing therapist, a lot of therapy, and they started to show me the other side of the world, a more caring, gentle, understanding side. And there came a point I thought, right, if I am going to stay here a bit longer, I need to find something to do with my life. I had no idea what that may be, but I needed to find something. I tried selling this, but it wouldn't go. It was as though it still had something to say. I thought, well, maybe that's something I can do. I have to learn or relearn how to play it again, but it can't speak for itself, so I need some help. But before I learned how to play it, I wanted to know, what is it? So I went back to the website, Fowler Hospital, and this is what I discovered. Apparently, around 2004, I was living in North London, and there was a dialogue coming from certain parts of the media and politicians that people from different cultures and religions couldn't live together, had to be kept apart. It was the idea of them and us. And one day I was about to cross the road and stopped. And there was a big Jewish, like a kosher, bakery and supermarket, a few doors away from an Iranian musical instrument bookshop. To the left was a grocer's run by a gentleman from Pakistan, next door to a Chinese restaurant. A little further down the road, a Catholic church with a large West African congregation. In the town centre, a Buddhist temple. Someone like me, oh, the largest Japanese community in Europe. And then someone like me, a Scotsman, brought up in England, I thought, oh my gosh, we are living together. There's no them and us, it's just us. I've got to find a way of saying it. But I'm a musician, not a politician. So I'll find a way of saying it with music. And that's when gathering the drums was born. There are instruments around the world representing different continents, different cultures, different religions, and rhythms from one part of the world are often played on instruments from another part of the world. The dundun and djembe in West Africa. I love to think of the dundun as one of the distant ancestors of the modern day drum kit. There's three tom-toms, pipe, medium and low, kinkei, sangban, dundun. Goblet-shaped djembe is usually played with the dundun. Another goblet-shaped drum with that buka from North Africa and the Middle East. The tar, or bendir, which represents Islamic culture. Side by side, the tafmir, which represents Jewish culture. The borak from Ireland is usually played held in the hand and used to play with a wooden beater, but I love to play with the pedal because it gives off this beautiful bass tone. Sami drum, shamanic drum from Scandinavia, is often used in healing ceremonies. The killout with the Inuit people from Greenland. Killout is often used to settle conflicts peacefully, where two people have a drum each and what could be called a drum pattern. At the centre is the tom drum, tuned to the Japanese akamono scale. And along with the chimes, and the chime symbol, to me represents Buddhism, which has played a major part in my healing. And they have the sound, they just helps you feel so calm, which is great thing when you give a TEDx talk and the nerves of the tabla represents Sikh and Hindu culture. Tabla uses a phonetic system where each vowel represents a stroke, play on a particular part of the drum. And often you're taught to speak the rhythm first. So when you do play the drums, they really are talking. I think in their own way, all these beautiful instruments are talking. And those to ask them, as individuals, to introduce themselves and play, each would say, this is me, this is what I do. But when they come together as one, then they say, this is us, and this is what we do. Thank you.